Welcome back to the climate responsive architecture videos. So we are going to see about part number 5. It is thermal comfort. So it's a very interesting chapter which we can know about how is the human thermal comfort and how is it reacting according to the environment. So basically, a fundamental definition of thermal comfort, it's a comfort is defined as the sensation of complete physical and mental well-being, in which it says thermal neutrality is when an individual desires neither a warm nor a cold environment in a necessary condition for thermal comfort. So for example, if we feel very comfortable inside a residence or inside any space or a location, the space or location must be having a desired ambient temperature and humidity so that we feel very comfortable physically, and that physical comfort is also turning into a psychological comfort. So it is a sensation which is more subjective, and it is mostly objective also in terms of calculation. So it depends on the whole human body's action, or the whole individual's action, or even the whole individual's context. So it may be a subjective context also which is defined as the thermal comfort. Now the factors, there are factors which are actually affecting the thermal comfort and which are divided into personal variables which depends on the each individual person's capability or individual person's activity and clothing. So these are the two dependable factors which we call it as the activity and clothing. So if you see the definition which is given in a book called Introduction to Architectural Science, it says the condition of mind that expresses satisfaction with the thermal environment, it requires subjective evaluation. This clearly embraces factors beyond the physical or psychological. So this thermal comfort is a context which is more even subjective. Okay. So now we have to understand how the human metabolism is going to be reacting or acting. So we understand the human body. Okay, the human body can change the heat. Okay, so there is a lot of heat exchange of the human body. So if you see, it is calculated like the change in stored heat, which is actually equal to metabolic heat reduction or heat production. There is net radiation which depends on the human body. There is some kind of convection, there is some kind of conduction, there is some kind of evaporation, etc., and those leading to a change in stored heat. So what happens is the human body is a body which can actually gain heat by means of the sun's radiation or by means of any other radiation. Of course, there is a lot of convection, which means the convection currents like wind movements which are taking place here, and there is some amount of re-radiation or the radiation which is reflecting out of the body. And when you touch the surface, for example, if you are going to touch the surface at the bottom or you are going to touch the surface on the wall, there is going to be heat transfer between the wall and the bottom surface, etc. So that is going to be the conduction. So once you are going to sit here, there is going to be a rate of exchange of human body's heat due to evaporation. So there is some kind of evaporation which takes place due to the temperature variations. So all these calculations are made and it gives a component which is called as the changed in store heat. So this is how the human feels comfortable according to the whole environment which is placed around him. So now there are a lot of variables which contribute to the factors of comfort. The first variable is the environmental factor, personal factor, and the, of course, the contributing factors. So the environmental factors, these are more of objectiveness. That is, you have the air temperature which is measured in degrees Celsius, air movement which is measured in meters per second. We have the humidity measured in percentage, and we have the radiation which is measured in watts per meter square. There are few personal things which can also be measured, which is metabolic rate. Of course, it can be measured by means of what activity the human is going to do. The clothing level is also can be measured, whereas the state of health and the acclimatization cannot be measured, but it depends on the physiological and the psychological feeling of the whole human being, so which is more of subjective context. There are few contributing factors: the food and drink, the body shape, whether the human is actually fat or thin, etc. And then there is some kind of the fat which is available in the human, and the gender and the age and gender is also a dependable or contributing factors of the whole factors of comfort. So generally, if you see the whole picture, the whole concept of the comfort depends on all these variables. But now, keeping in mind that these variables have to be kept in mind, and of course we have few variables which can be calculated, so we can use all these objective type variables which can be found out by means of instruments, so that can be used, and by means of some surveys like what is the state of health, whether they feel okay or not, or how do they adapt themselves to the environment, or are they changing the clothing, or are they trying to change the metabolic activity according to the spaces, etc. Those things also can be found out. So this is the way how we are trying to determine the factors of comfort. It's very interesting to note how the comfort is changing according to each and every location. That's why if you see even vernacular architecture, if you study about how Eskimos were there, if you study about how tribal people were having their clothing, etc. So it depends, like how the clothing depends on the various types of climate. So that you can see in the unit number 5, how people have made their dependent factors according to the climate. So we have the metabolic rate. There are different types of metabolic there are different metabolic rates for different activities. So when you relax, it's called 0.8. when you do a light work, it's called 1.0. so when you have an hard work, we have 1.4 and 2.0 when you walk or fast walking and running, etc. So we have a metabolic rate for different activities. If it's one, if you just do a slight work like sitting and listening to a class or doing some very soft work, it's called 1 MET, which is actually creating a heat which is about 58 watts per meter square. So that's the activity level. So we have the insulation level. Of course, when you are nude, it's 0, and if you are wearing the t-shirts and trousers, it's 0.3, and if you are wearing a t-shirt and also a pant, so it's 0.5. 1.0 is like a business clothing where you wear a shirt and you have a suit and so on. 1.5 is little bit a thermal wear where you feel comfortable when you wear this when you have a colder environment. Of course, when you are in a very cold environment, you can wear this thermal wear. So these are the insulation values, and the insulation values, of course, we have some values like 1 clo is equal to 0.155 metric squared Kelvin per watts. So of course there are, these values are also calculated. There are a few calculations which you can see later. So these are the two things which are very dependable for the thermal comfort. Now there are a lot of variables which vary for the determination of the thermal comfort. The first variable is air temperature, which can be measured. The second is the mean radiant temperature, which is actually calculated by means of some other measurement which we can see later. The third one is the air velocity, which is measured, which is what maybe meters per second. Then the fourth one is called the air humidity. As you know, in the earlier chapters we have decided, or we have seen how the temperature is measured, how the velocity or wind is measured, how the humidity is measured. Whereas now mean radiant temperature is a new concept which you have to understand. The temperature which is actually an average temperature, okay, of the surrounding surfaces, which includes the effect of incident solar radiation inside a room. So a mean radiant temperature is always calculated inside a room. This MRT is calculated by means of an instrument which gives you the global temperature, GT, which is called GT, global temperature, and by GT we calculate the mean radiant temperature. The global temperature is actually given by an instrument called as black globe thermometer. So now the mean radiant temperature depends on the internal heat gain due to the appliances, instruments, etc. For example, if you have a projector, if you have a computer, a set of computers, if you have some laptops working, etc. So these set of instruments or the appliances, the fridge is there, appliances, etc. in a residential setup. So all these are trying to, or these are going to give an internal heat gain, okay. So those, even the lights are going to give you an internal heat gain. So those heat gains are supposed to be taken care of, and that will be calculated for the mean radiant temperature. So we want to understand what is the mean radiant temperature. So it's an ambiguous, in practice it is mostly ambiguous, but we have a calculated formula for the MRT, which is called MRT mean radiant temperature is equal to globe temperature into 1 plus 2.35 square root of V, V is the velocity of air, minus 2.35 into dBT is dry bulb temperature into square root of V. So this is how we are going to calculate the MRT. Now MRT, in order to calculate MRT, we need to know the globe temperature. See, the globe temperature can be taken inside a room by this instrument called as black globe thermometer. With the black globe thermometer is nothing but a 150 mm diameter copper ball painted in matte black with a thermometer at its center. So this is going to observe the air temperature, it is going to observe the wet bulb temperature, and it is also going to give you the globe temperature by observing the radiation effects. Of course, we have something called as an environmental temperature and dry resultant temperature, which can be seen later. Now the important thing is the MRT, mean radiant temperature. So now thermal comfort, how it can be calculated subjectively, like what is the ways or methods to subjectively ask the humans whether they are feeling comfortable or not in certain conditions. So we have something called as the Fanger 7-point scale. So which is actually zero is nothing but neutral. That means he is feeling comfortable in that environment. Plus 1 is slightly warm, plus 2 is slightly more warm, plus 3 is very hot, minus 1 is slightly cool, minus 2 is cool, and minus 3 is cold. So if you see, like if it's going to be an indoor environment of a classroom, for example, we have a class of students of 40 students, and we have an outside temperature of about 35 degrees Celsius, and inside temperature without the fans, of course the inside temperature will be little less, maybe it is something like 30-31 degrees Celsius, etc. during the afternoon. So we have a set of people who are going to sit there, and we are going to question them whether they are feeling comfortable at certain conditions of temperature and humidity. So it again depends on the location, whether it is a Coimbatore or Chennai, etc. The humidity variations will be there. So when you ask several questions to all the people, so they might answer, I feel comfortable, I am feeling a little warm. Maybe some person who are very lean, they might feel very slightly cool, etc. So according to the subjective responses and their own answers, we try to calculate the thermal comfort based on that environment. So that is how we calculate it by the Fanger 7-point scale. And of course, you can find out by even a comfort calculator, which is an standard calculator, which gives you an ASHRAE standard. Okay, we will say about ASHRAE in the later part. ASHRAE is American Society for Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers. And again, there is something called ISRAE also, which is Indian Society for Heating, Refrigeration and Air Conditioning Engineers. So you have a comfort calculator which you can move the slider, etc., which is available in the net as a small software. So you have a radiant temperature, which means we saw about MRT, so that radiant temperature also can be seen. We have a relative humidity, of course you can push it and see. So what happens when you push all this picture gets changed, so whether it is warm or neutral or cool, etc. So you can find out like what is the predicted mean, what that is, how many people are feeling comfortable, etc., and percentage of people dissatisfied, like how many people are feeling uncomfortable in the certain environment. So that is how we are going to find out the thermal comfort based on the Fanger 7-point scale and also based on the comfort calculator. So we have in Fanger 7-point scale, of course we try to predict things and predict the subjective responses. So if you see the subjective responses according to Fanger, he has divided into two parts. One is called as the predicted mean vote, and one is called as the predicted percentage of dissatisfied. So how many people are voting for their neutral environment, and how many people are voting for the dissatisfied environment. So if you see, it is an inversion of inverted curve, okay, inverted bell curve or whatever it is. So if you see the predicted percentage dissatisfied, so what happens is only a few people will feel actually very comfortable in that same environment, because they might like the environment and they'll feel very thermally comfortable. So only a few people, like 5% or something like that, will be very comfortable, whereas a lot of people, about 80%, so they will feel extremely dissatisfied with the comfort environment, etc. So the curve is actually bending like this. Okay, so you can understand some few people are from 60-70% or 80% feel dissatisfied because it's very cold. Few people feel very dissatisfied because it is very hot. A few people feel very comfortable because it is a neutral environment. So this is how we calculate the predicted mean vote and predicted percentage of dissatisfied. So the next one, we are moving on to some few charts where we are going to find out the thermal comfort and also do some small calculations, etc. So first chart is the relative humidity. We have four charts. One is relative humidity chart, one is called as the bioclimatic chart, one is called as the psychrometric chart, one is the Mahoney's tables, which can actually give you the exact temperature and humidity, etc., and you can plot the points and find out what is the thermal comfort zone and how many hours are comfortable in a certain climatic zone. So the first chart is just to find out a very basic relative humidity. So for example, we can measure the dry bulb, we can measure the dry bulb from the dry bulb temperature, dry bulb temperature from the dry bulb thermometer. So almost you can get this dry bulb degree Celsius, etc. Now this is actually nothing but the difference between the wet bulb and dry bulb. As we said in the earlier slides, it's called depression factor. So we understand always the dry bulb temperature is always more, and whereas the wet bulb temperature is always less. So like 4 degrees Celsius, maybe like 30 minus 4, something like 30 minus 26, something like 4 degrees Celsius is the depression. So what happens is, so when you have this chart, when you do this chart, so when you have 30 here, when you have 4 here, if you see here, the relative humidity is almost 73%. So that means the whole environment is having a good moisture content. It's having a good moisture content. The rate of evaporation is also little lesser. Okay, the rate of evaporation is also little lesser. So this is how we can determine the relative humidity, and this is called as the relative humidity chart. Of course, you can find out the relative humidity by means of psychrometric chart also. The next one is called as the Mahoney's table. It's a very interesting table and it's a very basic table, which is found in this book called Manual of Tropical Housing